Grazie Paolo. Grazie Paolo. Thanks a lot. Good morning to everyone, Brazil, LATAM, Mexico, all the countries. It's such a pleasure to be here for such an important moment for Dow. And the truth is that, although I'm going to speak about the future, the way I would like to start off is actually going back in the past and telling a story. It's the story of how Polaroid was invented, the camera. Polaroid was invented in 1944 thanks to a dumb question of a kid to her dad. She said, "Well, Dad, can I see the picture that you just took?" It's a question that is normal nowadays, right? We just would show our picture on our smartphone to our kid. But it was 1944, and there was no such a technology to reveal photos on the spot. So Dad laughed, and he said, "My son, I cannot show you the picture now. We'd need to go to a camera, you know, like factory, dark chamber. We need a technician." But he became so intrigued with the possibility of actually, you know, basically publishing, printing a picture on the spot, that he went after this technology and he developed and launched it to the market. His name was Edward Land. He was a famous inventor by the time. And I would like you to think about something. Do you believe that any adult would have made such a question? Any engineer? Any technician coming from the photo industry? Of course not. But why? Because they already knew the answer. And we make this mistake every day. At work, at Dow, in the material science industry. Why? Because we actually look for answers, while instead in a world that is changing, with a customer that's changing, with technology that's changing, it's more our ability to ask the right questions, or sometimes the dumb ones or the hard ones, and not only look for the answers. It's about rethinking and not thinking. It's about learning to unlearn and relearn the whole time. Also because when we look at technology and the way it shapes markets, the effect is unpredictable and exponential. Let's look at something that we would have never imagined some years ago. Ericsson, one of the biggest 5G players, has recreated a whole city in the metaverse to simulate the effect of how, basically, their 5G technologies would interact with the city. They recreated exactly that through physics of elements, exactly through digital twins that replicate the real world. We can see real life and its digital twin being exactly the same, and we're able to make perfect predictions. We're able to simulate what's the impact on our customer. We're able to do many things that were not imaginable before. And so the truth is that we ask ourselves a question: who would have ever imagined something like that some years ago? And so this is a question that we have to ask ourselves more and more. Why? Because the world is changing. And instead of having an expert mindset in face of the future trends, we need to have what I call the beginner's mindset. A beginner's mindset is like, it's your day one at Dow. Every day is your day one at Dow. Everyone is your day one in the material science industry, in the chemical sector. Why? Because we take all our beliefs, our knowledge, our experiences, and we do not throw them in the trash, of course, in face of external changes. But we also don't use them as copy and paste blind answers to everything. But yes, we use them as a starting point. A starting point to what? Starting point to actually an understanding whether they're still relevant in face of customer changes, in face of technology changes, in faces of market changes. Because if for a moment, our internal rate of change at Dow is lower than the external rate of change, customer, technology, market, the world, well, we don't have to be mathematicians to understand that we're going to become more and more obsolete, and no one of us wants anything of that to happen. That's why we are going to explore today what are some of these tech and business trends that are shaping the future and that are asking for a different way of working, a different way of innovating, a different way of adding value to the customer. As I was presented by Paolo, I was the head of Tinder in Latin America, also the chief digital officer at L'Oreal. And although as soon as Tinder was mentioned, I know some of you last lost focus and prefer to have Tinder tips rather than going down this subject, but still we'll stick to the plan and we'll talk about future trends. Let's move on and try to understand what are the new characteristics of the digital world that are shaping business nowadays. Because if we compare it to the pre-digital world, the world where DAO was born 125 years ago, well, definitely it had some very different characteristics. The digital world introduced five big novelties. First, we live in an interconnected world with strong network effects. It means we're constantly online. We're constantly digitizing our channels with companies. We're constantly using our smartphones, our computers. We live on the internet, especially in the next phase, looking at the metaverse. And this means that actually the number of variables at play for DAO increase a lot. Why? Because our customer is more and more complex, and our end consumer as well. Second big characteristic is that everything happens real time. There's no space anymore for like hyper planning or for procrastination. Of course, it's time of being agile, of adding value very, very quickly to the customer. They expect nothing less than that. The third characteristic is big data. Since we are online the whole time and our equipments are, our channels with customers are as well, we collect more data. And with more data, we can make better decisions on the way to go when we look at innovation and adding value to the customer. The fourth characteristic is exponentiality. When we look at the rate of change in all markets, considering the material science market as well, they change exponentially, not linearly anymore. When something changes linearly, it's easier to predict. You don't have to reinvent yourself very quickly. There's time lags. Well, when something changes exponentially, it means that the rate of change is faster and faster, and it's us who have to reinvent ourselves faster and faster. The implication is that when we look at the material science market, it changed more over the last 5 years than in the past 20 years, and it will change over the next 2-3 years more than it has ever changed. And the fifth and last characteristic of the digital world is AI. Artificial intelligence, this new technology that threatens to substitute some of our knowledge skills, some of the ways we think, we make decisions, because if we think that we're better professionals or leaders or commercial teams just because we have more knowledge, we remember better things, we have a higher IQ, we're smarter overall, we'll have a problem, which is technology does all of this much better than us. And so when we put together these five big characteristics, they reshape power dynamics across all markets. Let's look to another market, not exactly the material science one, but the automotive market and how it has changed over the last 10 years. 10 years ago, you would look at the car making industry, and basically the players were all the same. There was no innovation happening anymore. Nobody would risk launching a new car maker. And who was losing was the end consumer. And then this guy came, Elon Musk. And Elon Musk looked at this market and said, there's many things we need to change. We need to be more customer-centric. And he launched Tesla with a new value proposition across these five new pillars of the digital world. What he did a hyper-connected car that is basically a computer on four wheels that metrifies everything that the driver does. It's 100% sustainable because it's electric. It's directly sold to the consumer. They don't sell through car dealerships and so on. He reshaped the whole industry thanks to digital and thanks to leadership, right? A leadership that thought differently about how we can use digital to add value to the customer. And eventually, in June 2021, became the biggest car making in terms of market value and basically outpaced Toyota and all the other big car making companies. And so basically the question is, so now what, Toyota? Are you going to reinvent yourself as well? What are you going to do? And so this is the question that we have to ask ourselves, especially when we're market leaders, such as DAO. How can we focus more on the customer and always be responsive to their new expectations and improve experience and efficiency at the same time? Because when we look at the customer, he or she is eventually the focus point in any business nowadays in the digital world. Let's look at Amazon, the most customer-centric company in the world. They have this practice, it's almost like symbolic, that they always leave an empty chair in their meeting rooms, right? That they take this chair and bring it closer to the meeting table whenever they have very important meetings, right? It's everyone sitting there around the table, and Jeff Bezos takes these chairs and symbolically leaves it empty close to everyone else. Why would he do that? Well, because that's the chair of the customer. That is the most important person in the room, although not being there. And although it's symbolic, it says a lot about the way that we have to be more customer-centric. Why? Because basically most of the time we make decisions without considering the customer in the room. And this is wrong because in a digital world, one of the very important trends that's happening is that the customer and consumer as well are more and more empowered thanks to digital. Let's look at the four big ways that digitalization gave more power to the customer. First, access to information. Our customer can read, inform themselves, they can compare prices, they can get in touch with our competitors easily, they can read reviews, and this empowers them to make better decisions. Information is power. Second, there's more competition, but not only competition within producers of material science, but also, basically, among channels. It's even a competition to get our customers' attention because they're bombarded constantly with inputs, buy this, buy that, download that. And therefore, our attention span and our customers' attention span is lower and lower. This definitely makes it harder to get their attention. The third big characteristic is that there are lower switching costs. What are switching costs? These are the costs that you have in order to change your supplier of your experience and of your business. What does this mean? Basically, it means that, in a pre-digital world, I would always go to that shoe shop in my neighborhood because its competitor would be far away. I would have to drive. I would pay gasoline and parking. And so I would continue going to that shoe shop. Why? Although the experience was very bad and although the prices were expensive. Why? Because my switching costs were high. Gasoline, parking ticket, driving, and so on. Now, if I go to the shoe shop around the corner of my house and the prices are slightly higher than on e-commerce, my switching cost is zero. I just open my app on e-commerce and I buy the same pair of shoes in one of their competitors. And the same for us, this makes it harder to get loyalty from our customers. Why? Because they can easily switch us, a DAO, to another supplier because we don't have the same power as before. And the fourth big characteristic is that customers are content creators. Not only customers, but end consumers. And so whenever they can create content through social media, through blogs, and basically, spread the word about their experience, well, a good experience can make them our marketing tool, but a bad experience can make them our worst nightmare. Why? Because the whole market would know, and this will create problems in the future and so on. I want you to think about the following scenario. Think about, and I know the Netflix addicts recognize the images of one episode of Black Mirror, the series on Netflix. I want you to imagine yourself living in a world where basically each interaction that you have is rated. And you have this rating like on a hologram, like on your head that everyone can see. Imagine a meeting with a customer at DAO, right? Imagine that he or she can rate you on the spot, on the way that you have the meeting, on the way that you follow up to the meeting, about your proposal and so on. And this rating is available to everyone else, to your boss, to your competitor, to other customers. I want you to think about the following. How does the way that you grant a good experience to your customer change? You will focus in granting the best experience possible. Why? Because you want those 5 stars. You want the best rating, right? And so this changes a lot the power dynamics. Again, we have to focus more on experience. Why? Because we live in a world of transparency. And although you might say, Andrea, we're not there yet, I don't know. Just open your Uber app and you will see that we are all rated. We already live in this world. And the second question that I want you to ask you based on this scenario is, what happens if we are connected the whole time and we're online the whole time, giving rating the whole time? Think about it. Well, we generate more data. And when we look at data, basically what happens is that the more data and the more interconnected we are, the more data we generate. And when we look at history, more than 90% of data generated since the beginning of times was generated over the last decade. Why? Because of digitalization of businesses, both outside in the relationship with customers, but also inside in production, supply chain, and so on. And so this does not stop growing. We reach the point where we have 44 zettabytes of data, which is huge number. If you stock this into iPads and you pile them up one on top of each other, it's 6 times the distance between Earth and the moon. So it's a lot of data. And you might say, okay, great, Andrea, so you're telling me just the more that I get data from my customer, the better decisions I will make, the more value I will add to them. Well, the truth is that it's not that straightforward because it really depends on what we do with all that data. Think about the following situation. One day you wake up and you feel sick. You have some strange symptoms. You don't know what they are. And so you rush to your doctor and you tell them, doctor, what do I have? Make a diagnosis. And imagine that the doctor tells you, look, Andrea, I don't need to see your symptoms. I believe that you have this and that because based on what you told me, right? So go home, take this, you know, prescription and just don't come back. How do you feel? Frustrated, of course. You think, well, they didn't do their job, right? Of making a diagnosis based on my symptoms. And you're like, Andrea, what does this have to do with us? The truth is that it has to do a lot with us. Oftentimes in businesses, we do exactly the same as this doctor. We innovate or we sell without starting from our customer symptoms that are data. We even can have these data, but we still do the same customer relationship, the same style of selling based on what worked in the past. And it might have worked in a pre-digital world where the customer was not as empowered as today, but today, we have to focus more and more on our customer symptoms, and the way that we get those customer symptoms is through data. You know from whose symptoms we usually start our sales and innovation process? Our own symptoms, our goals, our rentability, our products that are easier to sell, our inventory, and so on. And this is not sustainable anymore. And so since we always have to start from our customers' pain point, we have to understand that our customers shape their expectations based on the best experiences that they have in their day-to-day lives. Our same customer is also a customer of iFood and Rappi, where they have instant gratification. They have low-touch, low-friction journeys on their bank app. They have hyper-personalization through their favorite e-commerce. They start shaping their expectations about Dow based on those experiences and not based on what we've always done and based on what our competitor does. And so because of that, in order to grant good experiences to our customer, we have to understand what are their expectations. And as I mentioned, the first big expectation are low touch, low friction journeys. When we look at the digital world, we can better call it a phygital world, a world that intertwines the digital world with the physical world in a symbiotic manner, and where basically a report by Deloitte shows that in B2B sales, there's a true omni-channel, you know, basically strategy, where basically our customer usually, they check 20 different channels before purchasing with us. So what does this mean? They go to a competitor, they ask for a quote, they check inbox with another company, they check with another colleague of theirs. They use many channels, and therefore this makes journeys much more complex. And so we have to reduce friction, we have to reduce the steps in between and make it smoother, in as much as those super apps that we use every day do. So when we look at that, we see that basically also in B2B, good innovations are happening. We see, for example, in the agribusiness here in Brazil, Bayer launched a B2B marketplace for agro ingredients, basically, for agro materials. And so it's called Arbia. And basically, the interesting thing, it's not just an e-commerce of Bayer products to their customer. It's a marketplace where also third parties can also sell their own products. And the funny part is that also Bayer competitors sell some of their products on this platform, and buyer earns basically money on those sales through a percentage, through a commission. But even for buyers' competitors, it's so important to be on that platform. Why? Because it has scale. Because it provides a low-touch, low-friction journey to the end customer. And therefore, it's better to be there, although it's buyers' crop science platform, rather than have your own just, you know, alone. And I know about Dow's initiatives of e-commerce launch with a distributor and so on. And these are great initiatives because basically they help our customer have low touch points friction. This is extremely important because they have this expectation based on their experiences every day. The second big characteristics that we want to talk about is basically personalization. Right? We have personalization across all areas of our lives and not only through e-commerce. We have that in the health sector, right? The more as patients we are interconnected, and we see that through wearables, devices, Internet of Things, we see that through an oximeter on latest Samsung smartphone, what happens? The more data we generate and the better the, you know, like basically health sector can personalize our journey. Changing the journey from a reactive, almost sick care journey to, rather than a health care journey, we can call it a sick care because it intervenes after we get some symptoms, to a much more preventive and proactive, really, health care journey that is based on the correlation of some symptoms that we might have and the anticipation and prevention, again, of the incidence of chronic disease. And to me, the same thing applies to sales. Why? Because we have to change our sales relation with the customer from one that is pretty transactional and reactive, right? When they ask for something, when they place an order, to a much more developmental and much more proactive and personalized journey, which is, again, based on data. And when we look at the market of IoT sensors, digitalization of channels with the patient, it's a huge market, which is almost doubling its size over the next 5 years, getting to 2030, with a huge amount of interconnection of devices between the patient and the health sector. And this is extremely important because the same thing applies to us. Again, the more we digitize the relationship with our customer, the more data we collect, and the better we can personalize his or her experience. Third big characteristic that I want to talk about is basically instant gratification. And so, well, sustainability. And sustainability, we will talk a little bit more this afternoon. And sustainability, it's very important understanding that it's not only about PR campaigns and just saying, right, that we're sustainable just because our marketing department asks us to, right? As Larry Fink, the CEO of BlackRock, the biggest private equity in the world, said, sustainability is also about profits, not just being woke. And he sent a letter to all the companies that BlackRock invests into and said, if you're not going to comply to ESG principles, I'm not going to invest in you anymore. Why? Because, again, ESG and sustainability brings business results. When we look at how do they bring business results, it's because they actually are more and more top of mind of a customer that is, you know, basically paying more attention to these aspects. When we look at the willingness of US-based adults to pay for sustainable products, it has increased much over time from 2011 to 2019. We see a strong increase in people who agree that they will purchase products and pay more for environmentally sustainable products. And when we look at that, especially the new generations that are coming, Generation Z, are more and more paying attention to that. And so we see them being called the Gen Z as the true generation, the generation of truth. They want to know exactly how this material was produced, how sustainable was the process, how sustainable is the extraction of the raw materials, and so on. A fourth big characteristic is instant gratification. Instant gratification, the best way to put it, is through a story of something that happened with me. Beginning of this year, I moved to New York, and so I moved to the US. And I rented out an apartment with a friend of mine. And this friend of mine promised me that he would have a bed within the apartment on the first night that I would arrive and land there. But the truth is that I arrived, and the apartment was like this. It was empty. totally empty. And I arrived like around midday. And so I was like, how do I get a bed to sleep on tonight? Of course, Amazon Prime. And it arrived by night. And this made me expect the same thing from other e-commerces, other experiences. And oftentimes when I travel to other places in the world, I ask myself, why does this supplier does not grant the same experience, right? And it's funny because oftentimes, though, we associate agility and instant gratification only with quick deliveries. But it's not. Agility is basically how fast and how quick you are at solving your customers' pain points. And it could be through deliveries, but it could be through innovation. It could be through solving a problem. And within DAO, there are already great initiatives that are doing that. The Customer Care Center is a great initiative that has reduced SLA times, basically. And this is a proof of agility. And this goes in the direction of instant gratification, which is something that is much appreciated by our customer. Fifth and last big characteristic to grant good experiences is introducing new business models that are more focused on the customer. Let's see what IKEA, the biggest retailer of furniture in the world, does. In Switzerland, they launched a subscription-based furniture model, which basically means you pay a monthly fee, and once per year, you have the right to change that furniture. And you'd be like, Andrea, this is a paradox. Why? Because they sell furniture, and the more subscriptions they sell, well, you know, the least furniture they would sell, which is their core business. Yes, but in face of a new generation that wants to have access to things and do not own them, Gen Z again, they said, if it's not me, who am I solving quickly the problem of my new customer? Someone else is going to come in and take that customer from me and take my market share. And this is a question that we always have to ask ourselves. Again, it really depends on our quickness to react to changing customer expectations and needs. And so when we look at that, we see again that digital is a great tool for us to solve all this. Why? Because the more we increase and use digital, the more we increase touch points within us, between us and our customer. With more touch points, we do what? We collect more data and information. And with more data and information, we can do what? On the one side, internally, we can personalize the experience at scale, but also, basically, inside, we can do what? Increase efficiency. Look how interesting. Digitalization does not only improves our customer experience, but it also brings about internal efficiencies. And how do we do that? Again, through the digitalization of our processes, of our supply chain. And we see again that also the global connectivity in B2B markets is increasing more than double digits per year. And this is extremely important because, again, we do not only have to collect a lot of data externally to make better decisions, but we also have to do that internally. When we look at similar industries that I use as an example, I look at the oil and gas industry. There are so many touch points within the whole supply chain that are being digitized that basically the oil and gas industry gets so much data to make better decisions that one of the biggest players in this sector, Shell, is even doing experiments of basically how to use blockchain to basically collect better this data in a decentralized manner and better share them within a decentralized network. This, again, helps us to make better decisions. They even appointed a head of a blockchain unit within Shell. Sabine, I met her in a great event that Shell was promoting. And the truth is that, again, this all brings us to data, which is one of the five big characteristics of the digital world, and which is a key enabler of both, you know, good experiences and good efficiency as well. And so, to sum up, basically, we have to look at a great report that basically McKinsey put out analyzing the potential upsides of digital transformation in the chemical industry. And when we look at the potential impact of accelerating digital transformation within a lot of areas within the company, not only marketing and sales, although it's the one where you can have the biggest upside, up to 3% improvement in the EBITDA, and so in the net profits of the company, basically, we see overall digital transformation within chemical companies being able to bring an upside of between 8% to 16% improvement in EBITDA. And this is amazing because, again, through the combination of better experiences for our customer and better efficiency internally in the way that we respond to these customer needs, again, we have a lot of opportunities that are stemming from digital transformation and from us understanding better the future trends and responding to them in a quick, assertive, and effective way. So that's my incentive to you, that's my calling, and therefore I expect the same from each one of you being committed in this digital transformation journey at Dow and looking at the future in a very positive manner. Thanks again for your attention, and now we are going to move to a fast quiz to see how much of the content you've been assimilating. All right? Are you ready? So the way to go about this quiz is that everyone watching can participate by accessing the menu on the right on your screen. So don't be afraid again to answer, as Ben was mentioning, because we will only see the collective results. But we do need everyone's participation. So I will comment on each answer before moving to the next question. And the first question, I really want to see whether you paid attention to the speech, is which of the following is not a characteristic of the digital world? First, big data. Second, none of the alternatives. Third, AI, artificial intelligence. And fourth, real time. I'll give you some time to answer. Results coming in. Go ahead with your... It could be a tricky one. It's interesting as we drafted it. So pay attention to the answer. We already see some results. Let me see. Well, you paid a lot of attention because 88% of people responded none of the alternatives, which means, you know, that both, you know, real-time, AI, and big data, they are all characteristics of the digital world. So for the remaining 12%, again, remember the five big characteristics: interconnectivity, real-time, big data, AI, and exponentiality. Moving on to the second question. Which of the following is the best definition of agility? First, how fast you deliver your products. Second, how flexible you are in negotiations. Third, how fast you solve your customers' pain points. And fourth, how fast our inventory gets replenished. Go ahead. If you've paid attention to the speech, I even actually mentioned the same quote. It's exactly the same phrase I used during the speech. See the results, they're coming in. Wow, you paid a lot of attention. Even a higher number, 94% responded the correct answer, which is how fast you solve your customer's pain point. That's correct. It's not only about delivery, it's not only about the inventory, it's not only about flexibility, it's about responsiveness to changes in customers' expectations and basically problems. Let's go to the third and last question. Which of the following is not an element characterizing a good experience for a customer? First, personalization. Second, instant gratification. Third, availability. Fourth, low friction. Go ahead. Let's see the results coming in. This one might be a little bit tricky as well, and I'll explain why. Okay, great. So we've had 48% responding availability, which is the correct answer, and I'll explain why in a second. 39% low friction, but remember, low friction, low touch journeys were the first great pillar of a good experience to the customer. So the truth is that availability should not be something that surprises our customer. Availability should be the basic thing. Availability and, you know, being available to answer calls, being available with, you know, like our responsiveness as customer. And so basically, this is not what grants the best experience. This is the basic that we should grant to our customer. Very good. So now, basically, we are going to move on with a panel, and we'll invite our leadership team to actually respond some questions.